Yes.
Very good afternoon to everyone present here. I am Ved Priya Lahiri, Assistant Professor, DME Law School, and I welcome you all to the Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer Lecture on Media Trials being organized by DME Law School. Today we have with us as guest, Ms. Geetha Luthra, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India. We welcome you, ma'am. I would also like to extend a warm welcome to Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavar Singh, sir, Director General, Delhi Metropolitan Education, Noida, and former Judge, Allahabad High Court, to today's event. Thank you, sir, for your presence and for your blessings for this event. I further welcome Professor Dr. Bhavish Gupta, Head Academics, DME Law School, all the participants and faculty members to this event. I would now request Ms. Sri Durga TN, the co-host of today's event, Assistant Professor, DME Law School, to introduce Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer Lecture and to speak a little bit about the event. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Vedpriya. Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, whose path-breaking verdicts humanized law, was a revolutionary judge of the Supreme Court. Justice Krishna Iyer earned fame and recognition for his fair judgments, for his way of penning down the verdicts, and for his mastery over the English language. He made the unusual progression from a politician to the judiciary. He was a member of Legislative Assembly, minister, and a judge in Kerala before he got elevated to the Supreme Court in 1973. Justice Krishna Iyer had interpreted the guarantees given by the Constitution of India, like Article 21, right to life and personal liberty, for a new age, and also fashioned new instruments to deliver justice. His judicial remedies were sought through the instrumentalities of public interest litigation and broader concepts of locus standi. As a social activist, he championed several causes for the welfare of the people. The prominent, eminent jurist, Mr. Fali S. Nariman, rightly said, "When Krishna Iyer speaks, the nation listens." He is the author of many noted judgments like Maneka Gandhi versus Union of India, Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan, and the Ratlam municipality case. Justice Krishna Iyer was conferred the Padma Vibhushan in 1999. His judgments continue to be cited in the higher judiciary. Owing to his immense contributions in the Indian legal field, Delhi Metropolitan Education organizes this lecture series every year after the name of this great legal personality. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So now I would also invite you to introduce our guest for today, Geetha ma'am, and informer guests about.
Thank you. Ms. Geetha Luthra, the guest for the day, is a designated senior advocate and a very reputed lawyer of the Supreme Court of India. Mrs. Luthra practices in the Supreme Court of India, the Delhi High Court, and various other courts. She is the Vice President of the Indian Council of Arbitration, FICCI, ICC India Chapter Core Committee, also a member of Law Asia and International Academy of Family Lawyers. She is also a member of the Women's White Collar Defense Association. She is currently an Additional Advocate General for State of Haryana and Senior Counsel for Union of India in the Supreme Court. Mrs. Luthra has argued several prestigious matters in human rights, criminal law, and matrimonial law, including the cases of M.J. Akbar versus Priya Ramani, Tehelka Tarun Tejpal versus State of Goa. Ma'am also has been a leading counsel in many landmark arbitration and land acquisition matters. Over to you, Vidya.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So with this, I invite Geetha ma'am to begin her address on today's meeting. Over to you, ma'am.
First of all, my apologies being held up. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's a great pleasure to be in the august company of Justice Bhavar Singh and all of you. May I thank you for having invited me. The subject of media trials is something which is very close to my heart and to the heart of most members of society who would want due process and who would want that justice should not only be done, but should be seem to be done, to be seen to be done. The reason for this is that the moment that you have two parallel trials, one by media and one in the courts, then the question is, would there be a possibility of the judges getting swayed by that trial? Now, there has been a lot of debate on this issue, and the outlook of various countries has been different. The first aspect would be the outlook of a traditional conservative court like the English courts, which have held very dear and which have stood strongly for the right of freedom of speech, but they have stood even equally for due process and the fact that there should be a free and fair trial. The English courts, for this reason, have frowned upon any media overreach in cases of important trials. And I will now go on to tell you one of the cases where there was a departure. So the first thing is, even though you may be against media trial, there would be cases where there can be a departure. And this is what we have to look at. Where should the balance lie and how can there be a departure? In the US, the question is the right to freedom of speech and expression, which is covered by the First Amendment, and the right to a fair trial, which is covered by the Sixth Amendment. The Sixth Amendment has normally in the US given way to the First Amendment. So in these two countries, you will see a dichotomy where the English courts frown upon any interference, but the US courts give precedence to freedom of speech and expression. In India, we have always considered that media is the fourth pillar of a democracy. So you have the executive, you have the legislature, you have the judiciary, and the fourth pillar is media. But over the years, we are seeing that media has been playing a somewhat negative role. So one would be failing in one's duty if one doesn't see the positive part of the role media has played and the negative aspect. What one has to look at is this, that in most cases, one believes that a media should do self-regulation. In each and every case, the court's first refrain is, let the media keep a self-restraint. The very way, same way as, for example, lawyers and within the legal fraternity, we are expected to have a bar counsel which will self-regulate because you don't want an external regulation. Similarly, for media, you have the press council and other bodies, and the intention has always been that let media do a self-regulation. Unfortunately, that's not been happening. And one of the results is, for example, the judgment in the Sushant Singh Rajput case by the Bombay High Court. So, as I said, that the US courts allow freedom of speech, give it a free rein, but if there is anything defamatory, and if the standard of proof, which is so high, is not given for the truth of the allegation or the averment, then the court would come heavily on media, and it would virtually, the fines are so high that it could possibly lead to a newspaper shutting down. And that is why the press knows that the damages are so heavy and so swift that they are slow to speak. There were two important cases in the US, which is the one case which all of you as students of law would be familiar with, the O.J. Simpson case. So O.J. Simpson was tried for the murder of his wife and her friend Ronald. And the trial, for various reasons, religions, communities, minority versus majority community, became a public trial. So much so that we in India were also watching it daily. So it became a trial which was totally being watched with clear eyes by everyone. Similar was another case. There was a lady, Casey, who was accused of killing her 2-year-old daughter called Kylie, whose body was found in the woods adjoining her house. Now, in both these cases, trial became a parallel trial by media. Casey's case would be covered also by the newspapers and by social media every day. It is after that case that the US has started seeing that you may look at trial, which may be self-regulatory by media, but what about social media? How do you control social media? This is not the world of media. Media would still have a responsibility, but social media may not know the same sense of responsibility. Everything may be forwarded in 1,000 times or 10,000 times in a day. Who would further forward? So you'll have hundreds of likes, thousands and crores of likes and dislikes. And the message goes like wildfire. So this became an issue for the first time in the US courts. Yes, we've always stood for First Amendment. We've always stood for freedom of speech and expression. But should it be totally untrammeled, which we have permitted? Because you can call a newspaper to Brook. You can call the Washington Post or the New York Times or any major or minor newspaper, call their editorial board, call the journalists. But how do you control social media posts? How do you try and correct that wrong? And then has come by American jurists, a concept known as low-value speech and high-value speech. So low-value speech is speech which is not adding value to the information out there. And high-value speech may be a healthy discussion on the same issue. You don't want important things brushed under the carpet, under the ground, that there should be restriction on pre-censorship. So the attempt by the US has been no pre-censorship. But now these two cases and such other discussions have led people to talk about low value speech and high value speech. In the UK and the European Union, which have been, in my own training, I feel, they have been the forebearers of equality, of liberty, of justice, of rule of law. And for them, rule of law and due process was very important. No man can be condemned unheard. No person should be condemned just by a media trial. And it is for this reason that the English courts have said that normally when there is a matter in the court, then the reporting should only be the reporting of what has transpired in court and the proceedings, and not go beyond that. You can't be doing a Arushi Talwar case when a matter is in trial, impeding a bail plea, because ultimately we have to realize that judges are human. Judges are fallible. They do not live in ivory towers. So because we know this, the fact is that in England, because the rule of law concept and free trial is so important, the principle that no man is guilty and that unless proved otherwise, and every man is innocent unless proved guilty with the presumption. That principle of rule of law is what the English courts have followed. But during Lord Denning's time, the Times reported in its newspaper, if you would recall, they were the thalidomide deaths. Thalidomide was a medicine which given to pregnant women resulted in their children being born with deformities or still children. Now, many of these women and men were very poor. Pharmaceutical companies, as you know, are very powerful. They managed to ensure that the cases were delayed so long that one by one, each of the complainants was settling. They didn't have the wherewithal to fight a giant. And the courts then said, Times was sued. Times reported this and said, judges, please hear this matter. You can't be not hearing the matter. And it reported about these thalidomide case settlements and the fact that the poor were not having a wherewithal to keep fighting. And one by one, all the petitioners, which was a class action, were dropping off. So the court said that question arose, is the Times reporting prejudicing the judges? Should it be permitted? And in England, the normal rule is it would not be permitted. And that Lord Denning ruled that in cases where justice is being suppressed and delayed or obstructed, and there is a higher cause than that, then such reporting has to be permitted. So they went to the European Union, I believe, and it was upheld there also, this finding and this judgment. So therefore, we have to look at what the American courts have said, low value speech and high value speech. If you are preventing an injustice being done, then perhaps you can speak up. If you are ensuring that a Manu Sharma case does not get hidden because of the power, if you are ensuring that a matter is not being brushed under the carpet, which, for example, is the BMW case. Whatever happened in that, I don't want to get into it, because at some point I have appeared for some of the people. But the fact is that there sometimes, or in the Nitish Kathara case, I think it was the mother who was the wife of an IAS officer whose only son was killed, who by her own determination, same in Manu Sharma, Jessica Lal, the sister. These people, Jessica Lal's sister, Sabrina Lal, these people stood as citadels, and the press played a very positive part in trying to ensure that that the accused were brought to book. Very recently, Manu Sharma had served his term and walked out a free man. He believed he did a lot of good work in jail. And the press was again speaking about why he's being let off, why he's being let off early, even though it was in accordance with law and he was doing remission. So every time, each case has to be looked at in its right perspective. There was a time for him to go in, and there is a time for him to come out. So we have to examine both. So what I am coming to is the thalidomide deaths and what the English court said, what the US courts have held, and there would be many examples which can be given of the US courts. But let's look at our Indian context also. In the Indian context, you have case after case, judgment after judgment, where you would feel completely helpless because rule of law is being thwarted by the press. Do not, as students of law, be carried away and keep your sense of due process and the importance of rule of law as a fundamental principle for your sense of justice. It is most fundamental. Two cases come to mind. One I've just referred to, but I'll refer in more detail. The other, but both relate to Arnav Goswami and the Republic. As you know about the Sunanda Pushkar case and the fact that she died in what could be said to be mysterious, if not unusual, if not mysterious circumstances. So there were some pills next to her, which were sleeping pills, and the lady had died. She didn't seem to not have a will to live, because she had just spoken to some journalists and told them that she had wanted to meet them. Now, in these circumstances, she died. Arnav Goswami's channel carried a lot of news about it. in a sense indicting him, Shashi Tharoor, and a case was filed by Mr. Shashi Tharoor. Perhaps I can quote from a Delhi High Court judgment. So the court asked Justice Mukta Gupta of the Delhi High Court, who is a hugely innate sense of justice and fair play, kept the statement that was being made was that their investigation was much better than what the police was doing. And therefore, they had a right to investigate. And the court questioned the counsel for Goswami. Were you at the spot? Are you an eyewitness? So obviously, the both answers are yet no. Says, there is a sanctity of investigation. Leave investigation to the state. And when the state investigates, if you find a tool, if you find some information, you owe it to yourself and to fair play that you should share that information with the state. You cannot say that today India has discovered these three further clues which the IO, the investigating authority, or the commissioner of police has not. And the court said, this is not evidence. There are statements here and there. A court has to take a point of view on what is evidence. You are nobody in the field to get evidence or get access to evidence. And the court says there are serious consequences to allege that a murder has taken place and sit in appeal over a charge sheet that is filed or to be filed by an investigative agency. It's words which we all should take heed of. In the Indrani Mukherjee case, for example, there was a huge furor. There was a lot of investigation. A parallel trial was being carried out. People were being called, the son, the relative, the employee, the driver, the ex-husband, and a whole parallel inquiry was going on. Ultimately, alarmed at all this, the court looked at it and said, let it be sent to, or it was, I don't know whether it was the court, but it was sent to CBI. And at that time, the CBI made Peter Mukherjee an accused and perhaps arrested him. I, for one, find this not easy to digest. And I was watching that investigation carefully. Investigation is best left to the investigative agency. There are tools to be adopted. There is something known as a Section 156(3) application which can be filed. You can go to Commissioner of Police and bring him the tools or the extra information which you may have unearthed. And if then there is a mistrial happening, you can go, but you cannot carry on a media trial. I am very, very happy that in the Sushant Singh Rajput case, the Mumbai High Court has chastised the news channels, two news channels. I'm not happy about the names of those channels. They are immaterial. The question is, should we be cautious? And the answer is yes. And very recently in the Delhi riots case, one of the CMM, Delhi has, I think it's Patiala House Delhi, has said to the newspapers, on what basis are you alleging one community or another community, or who has done it or who has not done it? At least use due care and caution. If you report anything, do an investigation. I say further, once a matter is going to court, you cannot, or even if not going to court. And we have to look at this, that how restrained is foreign media. They will not show bodies in case someone is injured like this, to show that, look, this is what terrorists have achieved. You don't want to play into their hands. So media has to play a very restrained role. And these guidelines are there by press council. Now, how good will it be that the courts start putting gag orders in every other case on media? Isn't it better that media restrains itself? Now, two other judgments which are important and which I thought were very interesting, apart from this Sushant Singh Rajput's Mumbai judgment. In while Nirbhay's case was on, there was a movie made called India's Daughter, and that was being sought to be telecast. Matter came to Delhi High Court. I know at one time the bench was constituted of Justice Sanjeev Sachdeva and Justice Badar Ahmed. And the court said that since the matter is prejudice, you will not show the movie. It may prejudice the prosecution. It may prejudice the accused. It may benefit the prosecution. It may benefit the accused. But you cannot interfere when a trial is on. In this context, I would be remiss if I don't point out that while the matter was sub judice, Talwar was released, the movie about the Arushi murder case. But I'm not commenting on that. That was a case of trial. So it was a defense by media and a trial by media. It was, and in many senses, because person had already, there was a closure report which had been filed earlier. Perhaps the only choice was a defense by media because nobody else was listening to anything else. But we should not have to go there. No one should have to go there. The rule of law should be most important. Then there are some other judgments. In fact, there is an important judgment by the Chief Justice, I think it was Justice Lodha, sitting with Justice Lokur and Justice Nariman, in what is called as People's Union of Civil Liberties. It was a public interest litigation filed by PUCL versus the state of Maharashtra. And the court said that their newspapers, magazines have to be responsible when a matter is sub judice. They shouldn't be reporting. Similar issue has been said by two law commissions of India, including perhaps in the 200th Law Commission report. There, I don't agree with it fully. It says that once a matter reaches at the stage of charge, then reporting should only be what's in the newspaper, what's in the court, but I don't agree with that, because bails are before that. The trial actually by media becomes before the charge sheet is filed. So even the police can get influenced in filing a charge sheet. So the moment something is becoming subject matter of a criminal case, all reporting has to be responsible, has to be any investigation has to be done before any reporting is done, and no one has a right for a parallel trial. This, in brief, is what I want to say today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, with your permission, the participants have some questions, if you could present it to you.
Yes, if I can answer them, I doubt what they reply.
Ma'am, the first question is, ma'am, how does a media trial affect the mind of the judge dealing with the case? So does it affect the justice delivery system in India in general?
I think very, very significantly. But, you know, in India, we unfortunately do not transfer cases on this ground. In the US, at the slightest hint that a particular court, the environment is vitiated, the court would transfer the matter or delay the matter till the threat perception or the fear perception or the media perception reduces. As Justice Badr Ahmed said in that banning the movie India's Daughter, he said, judges are not infallible. We have to realize that. And therefore, completely, there are so many issues where a person, even if he has done a heinous offense, even if you are accusing him of rape or poxo or anything, for God's sake, let the trial happen. Ultimately, our judges are trained. They will convict. But don't let that man feel that I should leave this country because I will not get justice here. Everyone has a right to a free and fair trial.
Okay. Ma'am, one more question is that a student is saying that, ma'am, can we please know your thoughts on Justice Pushpa's judgment stating that mere groping will not fall under the definition of sexual assault? Did media play a positive or negative role in this case?
So firstly, let me tell you that I have settled the petition for National Commission for Women in challenging that judgment. So mine might be a slightly biased view. I feel that I would have decided otherwise. But you can't damn a court for deciding wrongly. The reason is, why do you have an appeal procedure? You have an appeal procedure to correct wrong judgments. And should I tell you this, that this very issue came up before the English courts, which is what I have said in that SLP, which I have settled. And this very issue came up, and there are two judgments by English Court of Appeals, I think, or maybe one is Ireland, but it's by the UK. And a man tried to grope a girl through her trouser, track jacket, pocket of her track pant. And the issue arose that it was not skin to skin. And the court finally determined, no, it was still sexual assault, even though it was not skin to skin. So it may make us aghast. We may not be happy, but we cannot go damning a court. I don't agree with this. I feel that, yes, media brought it to light, to that they play a positive role. But social media and media damn a court of law at the, that's not a good idea. Ultimately, we are students of law. We have to have restraint. We have to have faith in our appeal process. And let me also say that this issue came up in other court. This was a defense argument raised in the English courts. It was repelled. Unfortunately, here, the court did not repel and accepted it to some extent, because the court may have come to the conclusion that at least I'll indict under 354. I may not agree with it. I do not agree with it, rather. But the question is, we don't know what was placed before the court. Now, everyone knows groping is something which will be sexual assault. Now, somebody raised a novel argument. The court could have repelled it. The court didn't repel it. But the court accepted that it was at least outraging the modesty. I don't agree with it. I think it may not be a good precedent. I have filed, or I will defend that in an SLP. A suo motu petition has been filed. But while we do not agree very, very strongly with such a viewpoint, the strength is to challenge it and to get good law laid down. So that's my view on this.
Ma'am, a final question to you. Ma'am, there are cases like Sheena Bora or Sunanda Pushkar. Then there are cases like Jessica Love. Positive and negative roles both. So is there a law needed in general for media trial, against media trial in India? Do we need any kind of law? How do we go about it? Is it a case-by-case basis?
What, so, you know, Article 19 gives you right to freedom of speech and expression. It would be a very dangerous precedent if we were to lay down a law against the media. But the way that social media and media are responding, you did need a judgment like the Bombay judgment to warn people of the consequences of irresponsible reporting. I don't think there should be a law, because then you would be muzzling the press. As I said, it is the third pillar of our democracy. But that amount of self-restraint has to come. And I would be very happy if the Mumbai judgment has achieved that.
Ma'am, one final question that has come from a student, that ma'am, let's say that an accused somehow creates a public image which is very favorable, but the court's decision, as we come to know, supposes guilty. So what the kind of clash will it shed on the audience, and will this create any kind of sympathy against the accused in the court of law? Even if, let's say, there is some amount of paid media involved in the thing, because paid publicity is also possible. So how do we solve this conundrum? How do we address this issue?
So this is a very difficult issue. Media tends to be very emotive. And one of the worst examples is the Sushant Singh Rajput case. I have felt horrified at how we were indicting a person or a police force without waiting for the result of the investigation, or just because we were feeling so hurt at the loss of one of the people who was an idol. Now you cannot control social media so much or fake news in the social media terrain. But our national media can definitely, by giving two sides of the coin, play a very balanced role. So yes, you are right. And yes, if after that there is a judgment which is contrary to the public opinion, there will be people who will start damning or shaming. And I think we have to become strong enough and resilient enough not to be bothered. But there is human frailty. And if there is so much blame, it will affect the rule of law. So all I can say is everyone should be cautious when they give forwards and they give likes and they go into a terrain of social media. There's some very nice forward which I had got, which in fact I forwarded, which said that everything, sometimes I don't need to have a reaction to everything. I don't need to always be reacting or acting or forwarding or rejecting. Some things have to be left after reading. Just absorb them in your mind and let it be. Mm-hmm. And dwell on it.
It's true, ma'am. Very correct. Thank you, ma'am. So thank you for addressing our question. So with this, we move on to the end of this lecture today. I would heartily like to thank you, ma'am, for sparing time of your busy schedule and delivering such a productive and knowledgeable address. Thank you so much. And I would also like to express my profound gratitude to Director General Sir, Honorable Mr. Justin Pervasnik, and Head of Academics, Professor Dr. Bhavesh Gupta, for their moral support and constant guidance. I would like to thank Ms. Sri Durga, Student Coordinator Manokya, and Mr. Kush Kalra for their assistance in the smooth conduct of this event. And last but most importantly, I would like to thank all the students and the faculty members who actively participated today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we conclude this event. Students may stay back to record their attendance.
Thank you.